Welcome to the Afropolitan Podcast, hosted by Eche Emole, founder of Afropolitan. On the show, we chat with Afropolitans whose footprints form the foundation of systems dedicated to building the future of a bold and progressive Black community. In each episode, our guests share their working formulas, the hard facts about leaving familiar terrain, embracing the unknown, and staying relevant afterwards. Listen as we extract the blueprints of fearlessness, innovation, and progress.
Hey, Afropolitans. In today's episode, we chat with Morgan DeBaun, founder and CEO of Blavity Inc., a leading digital media company for Black culture and millennials with over 100 million readers per month. Morgan talks to us about entrepreneurship and Blavity's incredible journey. We hope you enjoy this episode. Hey, Morgan. Welcome to the Afropolitan Podcast. How are you doing? How are you feeling today?
I'm feeling great. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. We're excited to have you on the show today to talk about entrepreneurship and Blavity's journey.
Let's do it.
Awesome. Awesome. So in the stock market at 13 years old, investing in companies like Netflix, Apple, and Tesla, how did you get started with that journey?
Yeah, I mean, I started investing in the stock market when I was in middle school because my dad wanted me to learn how to manage money. So he used to play this game with me, who could have the best returns in the stock market. And so I'm a very competitive person and I actually won most of the time. And then as I started making money, I got my first job when I was about 15 years old or 15 and a half. And so I used to spend, you know, half my money on just random stuff like cell phones or games, video games. And then I put the other half in the stock market. So I've always been somebody who tried to build assets for myself and for my family and then reinvest, you know, my returns on businesses and business ventures.
You put $250,000 of your own money into Blavity at age 24, right? Could you talk to us about what certain misconceptions about what being a founder looks like that you're seeing maybe newer founders feel like maybe it's such a cool thing to get into? What are some of the misconceptions where you're like, wow, I wish you knew what it felt like to be in this arena and it's not always pretty?
Yeah, I mean, I think that a lot of people are seeing the headlines where they see their friends or people they know raise $100,000 or $1 million or $2 million or more. And it looks like, oh my gosh, this is incredible. This is so cool. Like, and it is cool. It is incredible. It's also an incredible amount of pressure and hard work. And there's no one coming to save you at the end of the day, right? So just raising $1 million or $2 million in itself is not success. It's a milestone to get to success. But the ultimate goal for a venture-backed company, a company that takes on venture capital, is the exit. It's a acquisition or an IPO, which is an exit on a public marketplace. And that's a very long journey. And I think as people of color, you know, sometimes because we're still catching up in certain areas, certainly in the African-American space or in our community, you know, we might have a false sense of accomplishment when we haven't. We should be celebrated, don't get me wrong, but we got to get to the end goal. Right? We got to get to liquidity, to huge wealth gains for ourselves and our employees and our early investors. And I think that's the part that people don't understand. You know, raising money and having a huge valuation is not the end goal.
So Morgan, a lot of founders struggle with, first of all, finding talent, right? And retaining talent. How have you navigated those challenges at Blavity, especially with, and I'll just give you like a personal story, like obviously because you're a Black founder, some people might feel, well, you should only hire Black people. And if you hire Black people, you know, this is, it should only be Black people and at Blavity. How have you navigated those challenges between maintaining a certain type of excellence at Blavity and making sure that standards don't drop even among employees as well?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely was of the military mindset of like all Black all the time, Black investors, Black VCs, Black cap table, Black employees, Black content. I mean, I was definitely that was like my energy when I first started the business. It's just not realistic, unfortunately. Yeah. We're not there yet as a people because it requires a incredible amount of network and skill and cash to work and scale a startup. So I mean, our first set of employees were certainly of the culture, many of which are still with us today. But as we started to build out new teams, and I needed people who were more senior than me coming in with 10, 20, 30 years experience, you know, it was difficult over time to maintain a company that was only Black employees. At the same time, it's actually better this way, where I still think it's probably over 65% of our employees are Black, identify as Black, or, you know, they're mixed race, Black and Hispanic, Black mm-hmm. and Jewish, Black, whatever, right? And we also have majority women leaders as well. So I think over time, what I've shifted to is you have to have an appreciation for Black culture, and you have to have an appreciation for our mission, and you have to have a strong respect and love of Black people. And if you're down for that, then that's all I need. You know, I need you to be in alignment with our business and our vision. And the reason why that's important is because there's some Black people who are not in alignment with our mission or our vision. Yes. And there's some Black people who are not good fit for the company because it's just people, right? Like our identity or ethnicity is only one part of our identity. And so it was really important to me to really narrow in and work with my co-founders to narrow in on what's the culture that we want to have. Who are we trying to serve? And if anybody in the world wants to serve these people, our community, and be in alignment with our business mission, then that's good enough for me. And because of that shift, we've been able to attract some of the best talent in the world from all over, Black, white, green, big, small, remote, whatever. I don't actually care. I want the best talent possible.
I love it. Obviously, it's still a struggle for even Black women founders to raise even today, right? But you've raised for Blavity almost like 6+ years ago, right? And even in that environment, it must have been super challenging. Can you talk us through what that process looked like for you? What sort of mentorship did you seek out to help you navigate even the fundraising space?
Yeah, I've raised a little over $12 million, and I could raise much, much more. But at the time, and certainly currently, I do not want to. And again, I think it goes back to my earlier comment that like raising money is viewed as the success, but actually what you're doing is selling a piece of your company, right? So every time you raise, you're selling 15 to 20%. And when I first started raising, I didn't even know that. Like I didn't know anything about anything, right? When I was 24 from St. Louis, Missouri, I'm not from the Bay Area. I didn't go to an Ivy League, like, and I'm Black and I'm a woman, right? So it's not like I had a layup when it came to starting this journey. So I had to learn along the way. I remember calling my friend Deshaun, who runs a company called Maven, who's raised so much more than me. He's probably pushing almost $100 million in funding at this point. Black guy from Oakland. And I remember when I got my first term sheet, I was like, they want 20%. And he was like, yeah, that's standard. I was like, well, I was only raising to sell 10%. He was like, nobody wants only 10% of your business. The lead investor alone is going to want 10%, and you need more people in the round.
Yeah.
And I didn't get that, right? So I share that story just to say, there's a lot of things and information, and it's a whole other ecosystem to raise money. And if you're a Black woman or a Black person who's starting on this journey and you feel like, oh my gosh, this is overwhelming. It's a lot. It is actually overwhelming. It is a lot, right?
Yeah.
So to navigate that, I talked to other founders. I met with people who were one or two steps ahead of me, like Deshaun, and I asked them for advice. I didn't go to big VCs. I didn't go to lawyers or other people. I wanted to talk to people who had actually gone through this and built something themselves. And that's why I spend so much of my time today mentoring and advising small business owners and other founders, because I want them to have real advice and real information instead of just Googling everything or like reading TechCrunch or trying to talk to other VCs about stuff, because VCs are a completely different breed. Most of them have never built a business.
Morgan, I want to switch to talking about boundaries. How in your personal life did you navigate how to establish boundaries in this space? Because obviously, you know, Morgan, it's Blavity, it's Afrotech. So many people always want something from you. I mean, I'm sure your calendar is always buzzing. How have you learned to like establish boundaries where you're saying, hey, I might be approachable, but I'm not always accessible, and being able to be firm on that?
I disappoint a lot of people a lot of times. I think that's the honest answer, is I have to be comfortable with the fact that I'm not going to ever please everyone, and that a lot of people may have a perception that I'm difficult, that I am hard to reach, that, you know, why won't she get on the phone? Why does she send me to so-and-so and so-and-so? At the end of the day, it's self-preservation. And I think that I have to prioritize self-preservation over anything, because if I said, hey, would you rather meet with me for 30 minutes? Or Afrotech will literally go bankrupt. Like, people will be like, oh, yeah, no, Afrotech should probably exist. I'm like, great. Well, then I don't have 30 minutes for you because I'm working, and this business requires me as a CEO to actively be an operator. Now, there's a lot of CEOs that are not operators. Like, you see these white boys out here raising all this money. A lot of them are not operating. They are figureheads. They did operate, but they got out of that very, very quickly, much quicker than Black founders typically can or should. So I'm still very close to the day-to-day of the business because I want us to keep growing quickly. In order to continue to be successful, I have to be really rigorous with my time and have a lot of discipline to say no, and then to also just have the emotional capacity to understand what that means. What it means is that there's a lot of people who aren't going to like me, and I'm just okay with that because they like my business. They like what we create. And as long as we're making things that provide value, and like Afrotech or Travel Noir or Shadow and Act, then ultimately it'll all work out in the end. Because the most important thing, you know, if Blavity wasn't great, nobody would want to meet with me, right?
yeah, that's a fact. That's a fact.
Which
so let's talk about that.
You know, do I want to be well liked?
That's a fact.
And there's a lot of founders that are super well liked, but
that's a fact.
You know, so no, I'm eyes on the prize, which is my first priority is my employees. So I meet with them.
Yeah, it makes sense. So let's switch to the pandemic, right? Pandemic hits. It's an event that a lot of us didn't expect. What was that conversation with yourself internally, and also what pivots did Blavity have to do to navigate that period?
Yeah, so Blavity has three businesses, and I think this is important to establish before I can talk about the pandemic. Mm-hmm. So Blavity has our digital media brands, right?
Yeah.
Traditional digital publishing company. We have a professional network and community for Black professionals and DE&I recruiting solutions for enterprises. That's Afrotech, right? And then the third business is our ad solutions and publishing business, where we help other Black publishers and multicultural creators monetize their website traffic. So if you had 1 million monthly unique visitors, but you don't have a sales team, you don't have the ad operations, we'll handle that for you. And we'll also go close deals for you, so you get a higher revenue in comparison to like these huge conglomerates, which can demand a much higher CPM than like smaller Black publishers can. So with running three different operations, I had to assess three different levels of risk. On the digital media side for COVID, the risk was actually traffic was great because people were at home. So our sites grew and our reach grew, but advertising was down because advertisers did not want to advertise during COVID and did not necessarily want to advertise during George Floyd, which was also happening at that same time. George Floyd's murder caused a lot of advertisers to pause spend because they don't want to, you know, diaper ad next to something about police brutality, right? Well, that's convenient and kind of makes sense for them, but definitely stinks for a Black media company where we make money because we don't charge our users through advertising. So we had to manage that, which was a lot of education and a lot of just public speaking and talking and pushing back with our clients and saying, hey, you need to continue to support us during these times. Then the second business, Afrotech, of course, is a huge in-person event, right? And Afrotech will probably be about 15 to 25,000 people this year. And so we had to very quickly in 2020 reimagine the experience in a digital format that was not going to be boring, that was still going to be magical, that was still going to help people get jobs. It was still going to help people spontaneously meet one another and also continue to expand the reach and build the brand of Afrotech as well. Because as a founder, you know, I never want us to have a flat year. We don't bust our butt every single day to not grow. Absolutely not. So it was important to me that we not only were able to maintain during COVID, but we're actually still able to expand and grow, because I knew once COVID was over, there's going to be a lot of businesses that went under and we were still going to be standing. So Afrotech built out a metaverse experience, which at the time was not trendy. I had to explain to a lot of people what a metaverse was, and we had a great time. You know, and it wound up being one of our most profitable experiences ever, because digital activations cost me very little in comparison to in-person activations. And it was a moment in which I think it really reinforced for our Afrotech community that the product and offering is the people. It is not a physical or digital event. The digital event is just the platform to bring the people together. And like that is fundamentally, I think, what really helped people understand, like, Afrotech is not going anywhere. We're growing. This is a movement. This is not just like a conference, quote unquote.
Yeah, no, totally makes sense. And as someone who's attended, I mean, I think all the Afrotech events since 2017 or 18, it's been amazing to see the growth year on year, and especially how you navigated the pandemic, right? Because obviously everyone was hunkering down and people were looking forward to just hunker down for the winter, right? And I think seeing you guys really come out there with the metaverse experience was inspiring, because it also showed what sort of founder and the team that you guys have too, right? Like, building when the world is crashing around you is such a different, you know, mindset.
Yeah, and I mean, that's what makes a founder at the end of the day, right? It's like, we're innovators. So that's critical, being able to say, hey, I have a problem, here's a solution. And you got to do that constantly, right?
Yeah, constant iteration. A lot of founders, and there's this topic about working remote versus coming back into the office. Where do you stand on that conversation? Are you more hybrid? Has the team gone fully remote? Where do you stand on that?
Yeah, I made a decision straight up fully remote. And we've been fully remote since the beginning of COVID. I remember my team thought I was nuts. It was like March 2020, and I ran a drill. I said, okay, guys, I think that we're going to get shut down for a long period of time. There was so much denial around COVID and how long it was going to last, right? But I went to worst case scenario, right? We were all like, maybe a couple weeks, we'll go for a walk, we'll reorganize our closet, it'll be great, and we'll come back. I took a more aggressive approach and said, this might take longer. And so I said, okay, we're going to run a 3-day drill where you're going to work from home for 3 days, and then we're all going to come back and assess, like, how did we do? How was the communication? What tools do we need? Like, how's your workstation? Can you actually work from home? And people came back. And then I said, great, next week you're working from home and you're not coming back. So take these computers, take these plants, take your chair, take whatever you need in this office home, because I don't think we're going to come back. And we didn't. We never came back.
Yeah.
And that was, again, being decisive allowed my team to, although they thought I was crazy, it allowed them to say, okay, I'm going to just trust her and we're going to do this. And then they were able to focus on the work. So while everybody else was adjusting to working from home, we were building. Right. And that was really, really critical. Today, you know, we've been remote now for over 2 years, and there's definitely some pros and cons to it. We're not hybrid, because I think hybrid environments cause information asymmetry for women and people of color. And as a community, and people of color, I am definitely not going to create more inequities than what the system has already created for me to already be challenged with every single day in my work. And certainly as a group of aging people where we're, you know, we're not 24-year-old, our average age of our employees is in their 30s, people are having kids, people are taking care of their families, their parents. And so working remotely has given people way more quality of life flexibility to be able to pick up their kids at 2 o'clock, you know, and get back online or pick up their mom or dad and take them to the hospital or take them to go to the doctor's appointment without feeling guilty about it or trying to hide it. I'm like, I don't actually don't care. Just put it on your calendar, though. Like, you know, don't have to wait for you when you're out at Costco. I don't care if you're at Costco or not at Costco, because I trust that the people that I'm hiring are doing a good job and that we're moving the business forward. Now, if people start to underperform, that's when it gets really tricky in a remote environment. I've found it very difficult for talent that's underperforming to help them get back on track in a remote environment. One, you don't catch it as quickly. So I can't see, oh, this person looks like they're struggling. Let's help them. You can't see that until it's almost too late, until the data comes in that they missed a sales goal or they missed a business goal or something was turned in late repeatedly. Like, by then it's almost too late. And that's what we're trying to figure out now. It's like how to help more people who are underperforming faster.
Yeah. From a leadership perspective, and I'm asking as a founder to another founder, I think when you start realizing that you actually have to fire some people, right? And maybe initially, I don't think anyone really ever gets great at firing, but those conversations where you say to yourself, okay, I have to let this person go, but where can I take accountability in my own leadership failures, right? Maybe I could have done better and maybe being more clear, setting better expectations, maybe establishing better goals, right? How do you navigate that conversation with yourself where you're saying, okay, hey, I'm with the employee where you're saying, hey, our journey together is coming to an end, but it doesn't mean that you yourself, you're a failure in life. It's just saying like this particular journey is coming to an end here. And I think we want to move in a different direction. Is there any piece of advice when it comes time to let someone go that you found helpful?
I mean, it's one of the most challenging things that business owners have to do, especially as you get more people who have children or responsibilities and you know them and you like the person. And it never gets easier. I mean, it just never does. I think for me, what I've tried to do is ask myself, is this company hurting this person in the long run? Is like this person staying on with this company for a longer period of time? Does it actually not advance their goals and their career? Because that's one thing that I'm like, I don't want to ever be the reason why someone doesn't get to hit their dreams because we say, oh, well, you know what? Joe is fine. He's mediocre. He's like doing okay. Yes, he's missing some targets. Yes, he's underperforming slightly. But then it's like, I know Joe will never get a raise because we are a meritocracy in a lot of ways. Like Joe will stay at level forever at Blavity. He will not get a raise. He will just exist. And I'm like, well, how long can Joe exist? If Joe's 30, Joe needs to advance, right? So I think about it from that perspective, trying to really have empathy for them. And then I think the other thing is you never want someone to be surprised. Like you never want someone to, for the first time, to hear that there's an issue or that they're underperforming, you know, so making sure that having a direct feedback loop is really important. Now they may disagree and they may lack self-awareness. And that's when I have the most challenge. So I'm like, oh, you don't know you're not performing. So there is a lack awareness here, even after you've been told by your colleagues and your managers. How do we manage that when someone thinks they're doing well when they're not? That to me is the hardest conversation because then they're like, what do you mean? What do you mean I'm getting fired? You know, and it's so-and-so's fault and it's so-and-so's fault. They take no responsibility. I hate that for them because that means that they weren't planning or prepping. They weren't managing their money. They weren't prepared for for the likely potential that they were going to get fired. And that's happened a couple of times. And it just doesn't feel great. But I do hold on to the fact that, look, I want to be a company where the top talent gets rewarded, that high performers get rewarded. And I do not think it's fair when people who do less work, who are less competent, get paid the same or get the same reward. Yeah. So like that's literally the inequities that we're trying to fight. So it's never perfect. I've never been perfect as a leader. And when it comes to people management, it's the most challenging part. If I could just be a CEO and not have to manage people, like Blavity would be making. Not gonna lie. It's a lot of effort.
Yeah, it is. And I think, like you said, it's probably approaching it from an empathetic standpoint, but also realizing, like you said, if this person is in this position and not growing or even, you know, has the ability to even be promoted, then it's a disservice to them, right? And it's like, look, it's better that we draw attention to this now and there's accountability taken versus we just let this stagnate and your time peters away.
Yeah. So I
definitely agree.
Yeah, and I think the other thing that I've tried to do, it's even like a candidate experience when you're interviewing for people to be at your company.
Yeah.
I've recently been interviewing for C-level executives. So it's a very involved process. You know, they meet with a variety of people, do group interviews, right? So this person's invested a lot of time to get to know this company and for us to get to know them. And it's like when that decision has to be made, because we have to pick someone, it can be challenging to tell someone, hey, you didn't make it, right? Like, it's not your fault, but you're just not the right fit for what we're looking to do in the future. And I appreciate the time and effort. And I think that's the key thing is like having a level of respect, like actually giving them a phone call, not just putting it via email and saying, hey, you know, I really appreciated the time you spent getting to know us. And I really appreciate the insights and things that you've shared. It's not the right fit for us today. So we're going to move in a different direction, but having that level of respect and kindness, I think is key.
No, I love that. I love that. Morgan, so everyone gets to deal with failure at some point, right? What would you say has been your most significant encounter with failure and what lessons did you learn from it?
Oh my gosh, I fail all the time. How much money did I lose on crypto investing? Like at least 50K.
Oh my days.
You know, like I fail all the time. I'm a risk taker, you know. I think the one that's hurting the most is definitely my crypto life. Yeah, everybody's down right now, but it doesn't feel great. And I don't know that it's a mistake necessarily. Like, I think I learned a lot, which will serve me a lot if I just view it as a like, okay, I spent 50K to learn about a new industry, be able to speak a new vocabulary. I met a bunch of great people. You know, it'll bounce back later. Maybe it will.
Yeah.
But it certainly hurts. Certainly hurts. I ask myself, man, maybe you should have waited a little bit longer. Maybe you jumped in too fast, right? Maybe you should have learned more and just watched. That's not how I live my life generally. So it is what it is.
But that's what being a founder is, right? We're supposed to be early adopters. Like we're the ones who get hit in the face first. And then everyone else comes and you're like, okay, cool. Is it cool to come over there, Morgan? And you're like, yeah, you know, it's a dish over there, though.
I'm like, it's, you know, it's hit or miss. I still believe in Web3. I still believe in blockchain technology. I still believe in, you know, centralized currencies, or I should say decentralized currencies. Obviously, I've spent a ton of money, not only on my cash, but I've spent time investing in the Web3 community. And Afrotech and Blavity has built our own Web3 community called Alpha Noir. So even educating our company, you know, I used to run company town halls about, okay, what is Web3? What is the vocabulary? Who are the players? Because I got to bring everybody along on the journey.
Yeah.
Was it a mistake? No, I don't think it was a mistake. Maybe should I have waited a couple more months? Maybe, you know, maybe. But now I do feel confident that if and when things bounce back, we'll be prepared, right? But it's just hard to predict the timing of things. It's impossible.
No, definitely agree with you on that. I these days I open Coinbase and just close it right back. Like I'm not about to set myself up for heartache.
There's some money still in there, and I go back and forth. I'm like, man, maybe I should just pop this in the stock market real quick since the stock market is down. I know that'll go back up.
No, I'm gonna ride it way back up. I'm sorry, I'm not taking nothing out because I need it. Well, I mean, I think at some point you obviously have a different relationship with money where you're never too low and you're never too high. You just keep it level headed. You can't ever be emotionally attached to the outcomes because that's a different ballgame entirely.
Yeah, I'm definitely not attached to money. I have my own moments. Yeah. Like, woo, all right, girl, we're doing a lot. We're moving a lot of money around. But I think being a founder of a business that my payroll alone is over $2 million a month. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So money, a couple hundred thousand dollars, when your payroll's over $2 million, like, it's not significant enough for me to sweat it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, we have $1 million days where we close $1 million. So my money mindset is very fluid, which I think you have to have a fluid mindset with money if you want to be a multi-millionaire and have a business that has a huge valuation. You've got to have a fluid perspective of cash.
Mindset. Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely. I agree with that 100%. So then, speaking of that, are there any books or three particular books that have had a profound impact in your life that you recommend to people? Are you a huge reader? Or yeah, are you more podcasts?
No, I'm a reader. I think for personal finance, basics, Rich Dad, Poor Dad is a classic. As much as I am risky with money, I also have a 401k that does this thing, and I have savings. So it's like, okay, cool.
Savings,
We're good here. Everything else is play money. And then from a leadership point of view, I think the 12 irrefutable laws of leadership is important because as founders and entrepreneurs, we're constantly having to evolve and be better leaders. And I think in terms of people speeding up their failure rate, because failure is inevitable. So you just want to speed it up so you can move on to the next thing. Yeah. I'm still a fan of the Lean Startup. You know, it's an oldie but goodie, but I think it's a great mindset book to help people get more comfortable with very basic product releases. Don't overdo anything. Like, just get to market as fast as possible.
And failing faster too. Like, fail forward, fail faster. That way we can get to the end. If the only thing left in the world then, Morgan, was to read a book about your life, what would the title of the book be?
Ooh, what would the title of my book be? Well, I can't tell you because I'm writing it. So it's coming. Forever. I have so much respect for authors. But my book will come out at some point in the future. But it's going to be about how to help people get over their own limiting self-belief of what they can and cannot accomplish based off of all the odds that are against us. Like, if you knew what you know now, would you still start your business? Maybe, maybe not, because the statistics are crazy, right? Yeah. When I first started Blavity, would I have started it knowing that less than 0.5% of venture funding goes to Black women? Would I have tried to raise, which was certainly worse when I was raising 10 years ago?
Way worse.
You know, way worse, like less than probably 0.2%, right? Would I still have tried? Probably not. So, like, it's a book about how to help you get through all the bullshit and, like, ignore the odds and push through with what your kind of core power is or your core belief is. And, like, let's just go get it done, right? But yeah, book title coming soon.
Definitely looking forward to the book. Before we close, I wanted to circle back to your time at Intuit, right? What was that transition like where you're saying, hey, I'm done with, you know, not necessarily being an employee, but I'm ready to take on this founder journey? What was that internal conversation with yourself where you're like, hey, I'm about to take this plunge, right? And I'm also about to put my own personal money into this. And I don't know if it's going to work. There are no guarantees in this. So what was that internal dialogue like for you?
Yeah, for me, I had to think through, I knew that at the age of 24, I was going to be the most risky I could ever be because I was still living like a college student. You know, my quality of life was mediocre and I had no kids, no husband, no responsibilities. So if not now, then when was really the thing that I kept telling myself, like, the longer you wait, the harder it's going to be. The longer you wait, the harder it's going to be. And then the second thing that I talked to myself about was like, let's not live a life where you're going to regret things. You know, I was living in a time in Silicon Valley where everybody was popping. People were raising money. Your Lyft driver had an app. You know what I mean? Like, everybody was ready. So I didn't want to wake up and be 50 and look back and be like, my grandkids are like, yo, grandma, so you're telling me you were living in Silicon Valley while everybody around you was getting rich and you decided to work for somebody else? Where'd I do that at? You know? And if I could already project that level of, yeah, I think I would regret not taking a chance and betting on myself, then this is it. I got to do it now. And that's just some of the mindset work that you kind of have to do when you're trying to hype yourself to do something irrational, honestly.
Definitely. Morgan, so we ask all our guests on the show this question, which is, what does being Afropolitan mean to you?
You know, I think being Afropolitan to me means being of African descent, of the diaspora, and being connected to our culture and learning our culture, right? As an African American in growing up in Missouri, I had limited exposure to the incredible diversity of the diaspora. I mean, I had some, but not in the way that I do now. And just such an appreciation for our ancestors and how we have moved through the world despite the world and power structures being built against us at every single step. So yeah, that's what being an Afropolitan means to me.
I love it. But I got to ask you this personal question, though. When can we get you out to Ghana or Nigeria? When are you going to come out here for a trip?
I've been to both. Multiple times. I just don't tell people.
Oh, wait, you've been to both?
You made an assumption I've never been.
Amazing.
Yeah, I'm not having a conference.
Assumptions.
Yeah, I'm not doing a meet and greet.
She's like, I came in.
Yeah, like.
So what did you like about both places?
I mean, Ghana is more easy than Nigeria was.
That's a fact.
You know, I think Ghana is more pleasant of a day to day. I'm probably gonna get some shit for this, but yeah, like, I mean, I think Ghana was an easier fun trip. Nigeria is obviously gonna take over and already kind of is. So I think from an opportunity standpoint, I love that Nigeria and Ghana, like, yeah, there's kind of a good collaboration with people who are investing in West Africa. I have a lot of VC friends who are investing a ton of money in both Ghana and Nigeria. So
yeah,
hard to pick, but I think, you know, I would put my assets in Nigeria, but I would like be like, can y'all just meet me in Ghana? Can we just go there, please?
That is real. So what we usually advise our friends who are like, hey, they want to come, they want to visit Africa, is we'll say stuff like, Ghana is like level 1 on Temple Run, and Nigeria is level 15.
Exactly.
So you gotta walk your way up.
I mean, it's great to see both.
Very, very different.
The sheer, like,
no, it gets perspective.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, I think it's the same thing with Afrotech, right? It's like, you can go to an Afrotech executive, it's like maybe 200 people, maybe 300, and it's like, it's a good entry point, right? But if you go to an Afrotech conference, that is like going into the middle of Lagos. Like, it is crazy chaos. It's overwhelming. It's so much blackness. It's so much fun. But yeah, you don't just like walk in there thinking like, oh, this is gonna just be so easy to navigate. Like, no, there's 101 parties. It's a crazy town.
Great time. And we're looking forward to it. Is there a particular reason why we're doing Austin this year?
Yeah, I mean, Oakland, we outgrew Oakland while we were there already.
Yeah.
I mean, those people who went to Oakland, you couldn't get a hotel room. People were sleeping on couches.
Yeah. That's true.
Look on the city. So we had already outgrown the city even though I did it anyways, because I wanted to try.
Yeah.
I wanted to try to put it and keep it in a black area. But we're just getting too big, and the cost of traveling to California is also very prohibitive for a lot of people. Texas, because of Dallas and Houston and Austin, the black population in Texas is huge, and people can drive. You can actually drive around to get to
Austin.
So I think overall, my biggest thing was value to our attendees. So like, I did not want the cost to keep having to go up. I wanted the cost to go down if possible for the average attendee.
Yeah. Yeah, no, and we're looking forward to it. We're gonna be at Afrotech and from November 13th to the 17th. So if anyone's listening, join us at AfroTech in November for a great time. I always have a great time, Morgan. And thank you for stopping by the Afropolitan Podcast. I hope you had a great one.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Thank you for listening to the Afropolitan Podcast. We are building the future of a progressive Black community. To join our community, you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Afropolitan. Be sure to join our Discord and Clubhouse community by clicking on the link tree on our Instagram page. See you on social.